Early this morning, at 2:56 a.m. local time, an earthquake unexpectedly struck the San Francisco Bay Area, being large enough to be potentially felt by 8.5 million people. With an epicenter situated 1 mile east-southeast of Berkeley, the magnitude 4.3 earthquake that struck caused the ground to shake back and forth for about a second. This motion was fairly weak, not causing any casualties or damage of any kind, but was nevertheless strong enough to wake many people who felt it. And since the most intense ground motion was equivalent to an MMI of only 4, I bet that at least one of you in my audience thought it was your dog pushing on your bed asking for food time. So, if this earthquake was so small and harmless, why am I talking about it? Simply put, its origin. This earthquake did not occur on the San Andreas Fault or one of the many very small fault lines that frequent the western United States. Instead, this earthquake occurred on the Rogers Creek Hayward Fault, a fault line that has a higher chance of producing a damaging magnitude 6.7 or larger earthquake during the next 30 years than any other fault line near or in close proximity to the Bay Area, including the San Andreas Fault. Whereas, the odds of the San Andreas Fault producing such an earthquake by 2055 is deemed to only be 21%, on the Rogers Creek Hayward Fault, that chance is 33%. This latter fault line is sometimes subdivided into two distinct faults, but if we count it as one, it measures 93.2 miles or 150 kilometers long. It runs from Windsor and Santa Rosa in the north across the bay to east of Oakland, Hayward, and in the far south the city of Milpitas. This feature is a right lateral strike slip fault, meaning that its motion is largely horizontal and not vertical, with the right side of the fault line you are looking at moving towards you in an earthquake. Today's quake represented the largest event to have struck the Rogers Creek Hayward fault line since 2022, with events of magnitude 4 or larger striking an average of once every 7.3 years on this fault. So, why is there considered to be a 1 in 3 chance that this particular fault line might produce a magnitude 6.7 or larger earthquake in the next 30 years? Simply put, much of this fault line isn't moving at the rate it should be. The Rogers Creek Hayward Fault, which accommodates some of the motion from the North American and Pacific plates sliding past each other, should be moving at a rate of 10 millimeters a year. And yet, it is only moving at a rate of 5 to 7 millimeters a year, meaning strain is likely accumulating somewhere, eventually to be released via a moderate, strong, or major earthquake, with this fault line being theoretically capable of producing up to magnitude 7.2 events for a complete rupture of both segments. After all, since 1850, this very fault line has been the site of 5 magnitude 5 quakes and 2 magnitude 6 quakes, the largest of which was a magnitude 6.8 quake in 1868, which caused widespread local damage to structures. And yet, despite the apparent rate of magnitude 5 or larger quakes on the Rogers Creek Hayward Fault being about once every 25 years, the last such event of that magnitude occurred all the way back in 1898, 127 years ago. Now, am I suggesting that such a larger earthquake is going to be triggered as an aftershock of today's lesser magnitude quake? Nope. While theoretically possible, the odds of such are modeled to be 1 in 400 during the next week. However, at least one lesser magnitude aftershock has already occurred, specifically this magnitude 2.6 quake at 8:01 a.m. So, while interesting, these two harmless quakes are not something to worry about. As a final note, I would like to thank my new patron, Jonathan Matthew, SED, for supporting my work.